My name is Zach Terry, and I'm the president of Maximum Life. I hope you enjoy today's broadcast, and I hope you remember that it's made possible because of the generous financial support of people just like you. If you would like to learn more about supporting this ministry, visit us online at zachterry.com. Now, without further ado, here's today's broadcast. Corinthians 11, if you have your copy of God's Word, open it up there. 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter. We're going to begin in verse 17 in just a moment. I've always been a fan of history. I love to read biographies and books on great events in history. And depending on who you're reading and who you're studying, different historians have a different approach to how they retell historical events. There's the great man theory. That is, a history can be told as a series of great leaders, men or women, whatever it may be, but to present history through people. There's a school of historians that recount history by a series of cities. So you take Constantinople or Istanbul and show how history unfolded in that particular city. Another may approach it through a series of military conflicts and look at various wars throughout history. Well, theologians at times view history as a series of meals, M-E-A-L-S, meals, that people participate in. For example, history began with a meal, Eve eating of the fruit and Adam taking of the fruit and eating. It was the meal of the fall. Then history concludes, the history that we have record of, in prophecy with the marriage supper of the Lamb, a meal of foreverness. In between those two bookends, you have two major meals, one in the Old Testament, one in the New. You have in the Old Testament Passover. It's a meal of freedom. And in the New Testament, you have the Last Supper. It's a meal of forgiveness. So history begins and concludes with a meal, and you have two major meals right in the middle. We're going to be talking about one of those in the text. Anytime we approach a text like this, there's a temptation as a leader that we should have communion when we talk about communion in the text. I'm avoiding that today for a very specific reason. Namely, that in the text, I want us to look at some of the surrounding truths of this particular text in 1 Corinthians 11 and prepare ourselves for, in just a few weeks, we're going to be celebrating communion at the Low Country Boil. So make plans to be there. That's November the 20th. Make plans to be there. We're going to eat the fruit of the harvest, shrimp. That's our Thanksgiving around here. The pilgrims had turkeys, we eat shrimp. And then we're going to have a more ceremonial form of communion at the end of that meal. It's very similar to what we see in the text today. So this will be a good way to prepare ourselves for that. And then again on Christmas Eve, typically we try to do about five a year Lord's Suppers. So we've got two coming up in the near future. So keep that in mind as we're looking at the text today. Food for the ancients in general and in Corinth in particular was very different than the way that we view it, than we view a meal. They didn't know. I mean, everybody in this city, in Corinth, had someone in their family within two or three generations who had died as a result of starvation. Famine was a real threat. This time of year, you know, you always had people feasting during the harvest season. So this time of year was typically a feast, but it was also a way of remembering that winter is just around the corner. And winter meant people will die. Every winter, people would die. And so food was a special thing. It was also very intertwined with worship. We've already seen in the text how they would eat meat sacrificed to idols, and that was so tantamount and co-equal to the expression of worship. It was a very tangible thing. They were much closer to their food than we are in our day and time. In our day and time, you know, we place the order at the drive-thru and hope they remember the honey mustard, right? In their day and time, they grew their own food. They had sweat equity in every meal they ate. If it was meat, they had slaughtered and raised these animals that they were, or they had hunted for the meat that they were harvesting, and or the fish, whatever it may be. So they were close to their food. So imagine you're sitting down to have dinner and you have a meal in front of you. You know that that's not something you can take for granted. It may or may not be there in 3 or 4 months. It's woven into worship, both for the pagans and for the Christians. Every week, we're going to see in just a moment, they had a meal together. It was a part of their expression of worship. They were close to their food. They grew their food. They harvested it. They prepared it. So if they just had something there, I don't get the idea that they ever had to hit pause and say, oh, we forgot to say thanks. No, food's here. It's kind of a miracle. Let's give thanks to God. See, they would make sure that happened. And it was the kind of thing that if by chance it was more than just sustaining but enjoyable, it was almost sacred to sit down and enjoy a good meal. Now think about that. Whatever you're going to eat for lunch, make sure that you keep these things in mind. All of those things in mind, when they're sitting down to have a meal, it was a special thing. It was one of the highlights of worship for the church at Corinth. So as we get into the text, keep that in mind. And look with me here in verse 17. Paul says, but in the following instructions, I do not commend you. So he's giving them fair warning, heads up, put a seatbelt on, this could get rough. Because when you come together, he's talking about the gathering. He's not talking about the scattering. We're going to be the church scattered momentarily. But this is the gathering he's referring to, the local New Testament church. When you come together, Lord's Day worship, it is not for the better, but for the worse. Kreison in the Greek, it's the word for better. And it means what you would assume. It means that you should be edified. You should leave better in quality than you came. It should be to your benefit that you were here. There should be something about the corporate gathering that you look at and go, I can't miss that. I know the Jags may be playing. I know there might be a big race in Daytona. I know the fish are biting. But all of the good that I get out of all of those things, as wonderful as they are, this is the highlight of my week. Now, is that the case for everybody who gathers together in church? No. A lot of times they're just jumping through the hoops. But what he gives us in this text can get us closer to that, to where our entire week, Monday morning, we get up, we go to work. Yes, there's ministry. Jesus is with us in the workplace. He's called us to that vocation. He uses that. He uses us on the ball field. We're with him throughout our day, but there's just something about the corporate gathering that is supposed to be, in Paul's words, for the better. So a couple of things just to point out. First of all, They did this regularly. We did it once a week. We're going to talk about it in just a moment, when they did it. And notice that the gathering was so life-giving and helpful that many, for the first 300 years of church history, would be equipped and empowered that they could face death as a result of what they were experiencing as they came together as a church. Two things you have to have if you're going to live a vibrant Christian life. If you're going to tap into your potential for Jesus, you must regularly experience solitude and solidarity. Solitude, those long walks on the beach, just you and the Lord, where you're listening, you're talking to Him in prayer, you're listening to Him, you're meditating on the Word, and you're making sure that it's authentic, that it's real, that you're connected with Him, and you're making edits as you go to your life, your heart. You're saying, you know what, that really doesn't need to be there. I'm going to get some help with that. I'm going to get that out of my soul. You know what, I really should be developing this discipline, and I'm not. I'm going to put that in there. And as you're walking with Jesus, that solitude, Henry Nouwen said it's virtually impossible to live a fulfilling spiritual life without solitude. For some of you, it's the best thing you can possibly tap into is just getting along with the Lord. And simultaneously, it's virtually impossible to live a fulfilling Christian life without solidarity, without coming together as a church family. But just like anybody can be alone and not really experience Christ, anybody can come together and not experience Christ. And it's very easy to do. It's very easy, just out of the rhythm. We come on Sunday, we do what we're supposed to do, and we leave out of here. We start at 11 o'clock sharp and end at 12 o'clock dull, right? We just go through the motions. And He's warning us here that that's not how it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be for the better. You're supposed to leave better than you came. The writer to the Hebrews said in Hebrews 10:24, "Let us consider how to stir one another up to love and good works." And then he gives an idea. "Not neglecting our meeting together, as the habit of some, but encouraging one another all the more as you see the day drawing near." So, solitude, solidarity produces a vitality in the Christian life. It's life-giving. Now, that's a key word. A lot of churches are talking about being a life-giving church and a life-giving ministry. I want to be clear on this. To be life-giving does not mean there aren't times where you have difficult conversations. It does not mean that you pull the punches or that you never reprove or rebuke. The very thing that he's saying, that when we come together, it should be for the better, he's also saying, and I've got some hard things to say to you. So he's getting ready to reprove them and rebuke them. So that should be kind of expected in an authentic expression of church community. Nothing is more essential for your spiritual flourishing than for the right person at the right time in the right heart attitude to look you in the eye, tell you, "I love you, but you are wrong." The best gifts God has given me throughout my journey have often been somebody telling me I'm wrong before they let me go too far. Now, sometimes it's always best if it's the kind of person who really has the platform and the relational capital to make that withdrawal, you know. However, I've thought hard about this. I've been in ministry since 1995. You can do the math. I quit doing the math a long time ago. It's over 20 years, 25. In all those years, out of all the people who have ever criticized me about anything, I could not think of one who ever came to me critically, even if they were an enemy, and leveled a word of criticism that did not have just a grain of truth to it. Every one of them. And if I can tap into that truth and receive it with humility, Did you know that even if the enemy, even if Satan himself speaks the truth to you, there can be good to come out of it. If you can receive the truth, here's what I do a lot of times. First time I hear it, when somebody comes up and they say something that's true, but it's critical or it's hurtful, we're all human, and it'll hurt my feelings, and I'll put the guard up, and I'll go home, and this lovely lady on the front row is usually what the Lord uses, and I'll go home to Julie, and I'll say, I ran into so-and-so. You know what she said to me? You know what he said to me? And Julie will say, what on earth did they say? Obviously, it was something pretty bad. I said, I think they're full of it. They said, and then I'll say what they said. Can you believe they said that to me? And she'll just go, Well, you don't think there's anything to it, do you? Well, and then I'm like, oh, shoot. I've got to learn to quit asking her these things, right? But when I think on it, honestly, I can't remember a single time where anybody criticized me that there wasn't at least a kernel of truth to it that I could benefit from if I would receive it the right way. Now, they may not have meant it well. What they meant for evil, however, God may have meant for good. And I've got to find the good in what's being said. Does that make sense? Now, if you think, well, I'm going to bless him and tell him a few things he could change. Please don't. That's not the point. Okay? This is about you, not me. But with that said, that's how it works. So we should, a life-giving church and church service should have some of that involved. This is just sort of parenthetical. If you're a parent, it's part of your job description to correct, right? You're to discipline your children in the Lord. So you know it's coming. You know, if you look into the future and you've got a kid who's under 18 or living under your resources, whatever it may be, you know the day's coming when you're going to have to restrict some of their access, maybe take away phone privileges. You know, you may have to take the keys at some point. You know it's coming. Knowing that it's coming, begin today to make deposits. Knowing you're going to have to make a withdrawal at some point. Make deposits into that account so they don't question your heart when you have to make that withdrawal. There's times in my life where I've made too many withdrawals and not enough deposits to my children. You know it's going to happen. So go home today. When you sit down at lunch, whatever the rest of your day holds, keep that in mind. Also, if I'm right, if part of a life-giving ministry means that you're going to have to make some withdrawals sometime relationally, and you're going to have to reprove and rebuke at times, begin today. Begin today to make deposits. Look around the congregation and just go, I'm going to make a touch. I'm going to love on the people, especially those in my circle of influence, so that when that day comes that I lovingly have to sit down and just kind of have a sit-down, come-to-Jesus moment, they know at least I've made an investment in their soul. Does that make sense? Thirdly, so sit down with your family, invest in them, knowing you'll have to make a withdrawal, do it with your church. Thirdly, chances are somebody at some point is going to need to have a sit-down with you. So begin now. Preparing your heart and preparing your soul for the time that somebody loves you enough to sit down and say, the way that you're treating your bride does not look to me the way it should for a Christian man. The way you speak to your children, the way you lose your temper at work, the way you treat your employees or employer, it's not in keeping with the gospel. If somebody does that, prepare and ask the Lord to have you in a place of humility so that you can receive it when the time comes. It's a part of a life-giving fellowship. Verse 18. And he says that this church, they're not benefiting for the better, it's for the worse. Why? Verse 18. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I believe it in part. Now look at verse 19. Very important text. For there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized. You would sort of expect Paul to say, I hear there's divisions and there shouldn't be any. The church should always be unified on everything. And Paul says that's not the case. He says there must be divisions among you because truth has a polarizing effect. And when you stand on the truth, when you practice the truth, when you proclaim the truth, it will cause some, you know, he said in another place, it's an aroma of life unto life to some and death unto death to others. What does that mean? It's the same cologne. Some people love it, some people hate it. Have you ever been around somebody that they love their perfume? You don't love their perfume, right? It smells horrible. It gives you a headache. Don't point. I would say, don't wear that stuff to church. Just tone it down, okay? But nevertheless, if you buy it at CVS, it's probably not what you ought to wear to church. But anyway. There's some, if you proclaim truth at times to people who love Jesus and who are growing, who are mature, they love it. They're like, thank you, Jesus, that somebody spoke the truth. When you proclaim the same truth, others hear it, and it sounds like you're a terrorist to them. It's the same truth, but that's just the nature of truth. It's polarizing, so there must be, at times, divisions so that those who are authentic and genuine may be evident, Paul says. He uses two words. The first word is the word for divisions. It's schisma, where we get our word schismata. It means to be divided because of conflict. The second word, factions, is the word that we get our word heresies from. So this is a conflict related to a belief that has produced a behavior. Every behavior is tied to a belief. If you don't like how you behave, change what you believe. It begins with a belief. And so he says, he's not critiquing them or criticizing them for cliques, per se. Although cliques are dangerous for a church. That's not what he's talking about here. You know, where you kind of grew up with somebody and you're really close to them, and so you kind of can get to church and just gather with those people that you know and forget about other people that may need you. That's dangerous, but that's not what he's talking about here. He's talking about people who have divided over a belief that's produced a behavior. And we're going to see that that was never more evident in verse 20 than it was at the Lord's table. Look at what he says. When you come together, it is not the Lord's supper that you eat. It's your supper. It's not his. Seven things, observations, that in order to comprehend the text, you have to understand these seven observations. Number one, they gathered officially on Sundays. Ironically, every culture has had a seven-day week throughout history. And nobody really knows where it came from except for the creation narrative. Now think about this. How many days roughly are in a year in most calendars? 365. Because it takes 365 days to what? Orbit around the sun. Days are roughly 24 hours. Why? The revolution of the earth. We know where months come from, the waxing and waning of the moon. But where do weeks come from? Where do we get the idea of marking? Why is it not 6-day weeks or 5-day weeks? Nobody really knows. Sociologists, anthropologists, they really don't know where the 7-day week came from. But it's always been the case. We've always had 7 days in a week. Well, Sunday, which was the first day of the week, they looked at Sunday the way we look at Monday. It was when you go back to work. You take, for the Jews, it was the Sabbath. Saturday was off. You focused on God. You focused on worship. Then on Sunday, you get up and go to work. I'll show you why that's important in just a moment. But notice here, one of the great arguments for the validity of the resurrection is that the day of worship for these Jewish people, the early Christians were all Jews first, shifted from Sabbath to Sunday. Why is that important? Because that's like one of the top 10. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. That's a big deal. So for a man who's been raised in a Jewish context to suddenly change his day of worship, something dramatic must have happened, and it did. But we look at the text and we see that they worshiped on the Lord's Day. Now keep in mind, this is descriptive, not prescriptive. He does not say anywhere in the text, thou shalt worship only on the Lord's Day. Or when you gather, it must always be on the Lord's Day. We don't have a prescriptive. So if there is a church, I have friends who are Seventh-day Adventist. They're evangelical forms of Seventh-day Adventist. We don't have a problem with them for worshiping on Saturday. That's what they do. However, it's not in keeping with the tradition that the apostles gave us. Let me show you why. When Jesus rose from the dead, what day of the week was that on? Sunday, the Lord's Day. When he first met with his disciples after the resurrection, he met on Sunday. Every occasion we have of him gathering with the disciples to teach and to fellowship and have worship, every one of them was on a Sunday. He imparted the Holy Spirit to his disciples. You know, when he called the disciples together and blew on them, said, "Receive you the Holy Spirit," that was on a Sunday. The church as a whole, when he, on the day of Pentecost, when he empowered them for ministry, guess what day it was? Sunday. He ascended to heaven. Guess what day it was? Sunday. So the rhythm that we have, he tells the church, when you bring your offerings, your financial gifts back to God, do that on a Sunday. It's always on a Sunday. So the early church gathered together, and they did it on the first day of the week, on Sunday. Secondly, it appears they gathered for evenings rather than, like we do, mornings. Now, that's a little harder to see in the text, but just notice that the text does call it the Lord's Supper, not the Lord's breakfast. Incidental, it's not fundamental, but just notice it. It was the primary meal of the day, typically eaten before sleep. They gathered together in the evenings because it was a work day. Nobody got off on Sunday in Corinth. They went and they worked the fields, they opened the shops, they did their thing, and then they came together, probably in Chloe's house or in one of the houses there in the city, and they had the more formal time of worship. In our country, in the founding of our country, we had both people from the Jewish background and the Christian background, so we get 2 days for a weekend. But that's unusual historically. Typically, it's one. Third, the Lord's Supper in the early church seems to have been taken at every Lord's Day gathering. In a Baptist context, we take communion or the Lord's Supper about 5 times a year. That's what we go for. We've got 2 coming up, 1 at the Low Country Boil. We've got 1 coming up on Christmas Eve. They did it practically, literally, it seems, from history, every time they gathered on the Lord's Day. They used communion the way we use an invitation. If you're new to a Baptist church, at the end of our service, I'll say a prayer, and then we have what we call the invitation, a time of response. Our pastors come down here to the stage. We pray with people. Sometimes it's people who want to join the church or need to become a Christian. Sometimes they just need prayer or counsel. That takes place during the invitation. For the early church, historically, the invitation is a relatively new thing. Historically, the invitation was communion. It's like before we have the formal communion, we need to get our hearts right before the Lord. They treated it like the invitation. Fifthly, real wine was used for the Lord's Supper. Now, we're not going to do that because we're Baptist. And Baptists can't take a shot of NyQuil and act right. So, but understand, they did. Jesus did not turn water into grape juice. He turned it into wine. In communion, they were drinking some level of alcohol. How do we know that? Because they're getting drunk off of it. I promise you, you can't get drunk off of Welch's. This was real wine that they were drinking. That's important. I'm going to show you why in just a moment, because what they were doing was because of that. During the Prohibition era, Dr. Welch developed this process of pasteurizing grape juice to stop the fermentation process. And he did that specifically for communion services. But you take any juice that has sugar in it and you harvest it in its season, and then you store it either in a skin or in a jar, what's going to happen? It's going to ferment. They watered it down. They would cut it from time to time. But it did. The fermentation process happened until pasteurization was discovered. So in the early church, that was the case. They were partaking in real wine for their communion. Number six, the ceremonial observation of the Lord's Supper was preceded by a large meal. In Jude 12, it calls it the agape feast, the love feast. So what we do on the Low Country Boil, they did every week. They would have a potluck meal. Everybody would prepare. They would come together. You had people who were very poor. You had slaves in the church. And they would look forward all week to this meal. And they would come there, and everybody would enjoy food together. And then they would transition to more of a ceremonial time, to where they had sort of that token meal. Somebody said, "Pastor, it's always oyster crackers and a shot glass." But you have that sort of token meal of communion. And the reason why we don't make that a big meal, one, is because that's the way Jesus did it. He just took a little bit of bread and a little bit of the wine. But two, the meaning of the meal is not in the actual elements. It's in what it's pointing to. So that doesn't lessen the effect of the elements. It raises them. I've got a ring here that I've worn for years that, in a sense, is just a cold piece of metal. It's gold. I can take that off. I'm no less married. But this ring is meaningful. It points to something substantial in my life. So could I replace it? Sure, but it's kind of hard to do that. Julie's the same way. I'm like, "I could get you a bigger diamond now. You want me to get you a bigger diamond?" She's like, "No, I like this one." Why? Because the symbol points to something that's unique to us. And the symbol of communion, the bread and the wine, it points to the torn body and the shed blood of Jesus Christ, who loved you and me so much that he would die on our behalf. And so when we partake in that, we feast on the benefits of what he did. And we remember it's not just for me, but it's for us. And when you do that as a church, it's a powerful thing. We'll see why in just a moment. He says in verse 21, "For in eating," so when you come together for communion, "each one goes ahead with his own meal." So rather than waiting till we're all together and partaking at the same time, what would happen is the wealthier people who didn't have to work the fields would get there early. They'd start pigging out on the buffet. They would start drinking the wine. And he says, in eating, each one goes ahead and eats his own meal. One goes hungry. The poor people get there and there's nothing to eat. And another gets drunk. What? Do you not have houses in which to eat and drink? Or do you suppose that the church of, or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you in this? No, I will not. So he's furious with the church. You can kind of hear it in the writing. And then he points back to the first communion, verse 23. "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took the bread." Hey, parenthetically, when 1 Corinthians was written, the Gospels had not been penned, incidentally. So these stories were oral tradition. They couldn't turn to text and verse at this point. So he's pointing them to this reality, and he says, "And when he had given thanks, Jesus, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." It becomes an act of worship that serves sort of like a spiritual global positioning system. Don't you thank God for Apple Maps? Can you imagine going anywhere? I don't think I could make it to Yulee without Apple Maps, you know? I mean, maps, the GPS innovation is massively helpful. Well, spiritually, communion kind of serves the same purpose. A GPS system works on a complex algorithm formula that uses two concepts known as triangulation and trilateration. And so kind of the layman's version of it is there are at least three satellites that are in view of your device at all times. By measuring your relative distance from each of those satellites, it can pinpoint exactly where you're at on planet Earth. And then by knowing where you want to go, it can show you the best way to get there. When we take communion, right now we're participating by taking the elements in and feasting on what they represent. So that's in the present. We're looking back into the past that when Jesus actually died on the cross, his body was torn open, his blood was spilled out on our behalf. So we're part of this great story that from the beginning, God's attempt to rescue his bride and to pay the debt that they owed, he paid for it on the cross. Here we are, 2,000 years removed, in the here and now, celebrating it, remembering it, believing it. And it says, until he comes again. It points to the future, that one day he's coming back. And Jesus said, "I'm not going to take communion until we take it again in the kingdom." Jesus has not had official communion since the Last Supper. And then when the kingdom comes, he will sit down and we will celebrate it together at the marriage supper of the Lamb. Won't that be beautiful? And so it reminds us in the mundane unfolding of life that our little story is a part of a much bigger story that we can position ourselves rightly in and as a result make better decisions and have a stronger faith. And that's how it's supposed to serve us. And he's pointing to that, and he says in verse 27, "Whoever therefore eats the bread and drinks the cup in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord." So what's happening? If they come there and they forget that Jesus didn't just die for me, he died, as we would say in the South, for all y'all. He died for, and I'm looking around, each person, Jesus Christ died for you just as much as he did for me. He loves me not one ounce more than he loves you. So how dare I go in front of you and say, "Well, I'm just taking care of my stuff." How dare I do that? This is something I should wait on you for us to all come together and participate in the elements together. Because it was for the church, it was for all of us that he gave his life. And he says, if you fail to do that and you make it all about you, then you're bringing guilt upon yourself and judgment. Look at verse 28. "Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup." Hit pause. So imagine that, fast forward to November the 20th, we're having the Low Country Boil. We're all having fun. There's plenty of shrimp. There's cocktail sauce, hush puppies. Everything's good. Everybody's happy. Then we hit pause, and we take a moment. Hopefully, we don't wait till that night to do it, but we begin to just examine ourselves and ask ourselves, just like at an invitation, is there anything that needs to change? Am I at odds with somebody in the church family or in the community? Have I done all that I can to live at peace with all men? Have I lied about something? Have I stolen? Have I said something that was untrue? And just taking an inventory and just saying, okay, the best I know how, and you'll never remember it all, but the best I know how, I'm confessed up before Jesus, and then clean conscience and clean hands, partake of communion. He says, if you don't stop and do that, then you're bringing judgment on yourself. It's a scary thing, and it's a serious thing. He says in verse 29, for anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. And that is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. He said, there's some of you that you're 30, but your strength is like you're 50. Or you're 50 and your strength is like you're 80. It just doesn't add up. You ain't got that many miles on the tires yet. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't add up while you're weak. He said, others of you, you keep getting sick. You go from sickness to sickness to sickness. Now that happens in the world. Sickness, every sickness is not judgment. Sometimes it's just to show you that God is faithful. That was the case with Paul's eyes. But some of you are getting sick when you ought not be getting sick. And he says, then there's some of you that died, that have died. And he said, there are some empty seats at the table. And he said, the reason for that is you didn't take the Lord's Supper seriously. And you rushed through it. You made it about you. You didn't evaluate yourself. Now remember, we said the way that they use the Lord's Supper is kind of tantamount to how we do the invitation. It's every Sunday. And every Sunday we preach the Bible, and every Sunday we give the invitation. Our pastors come down here, and you have an opportunity to respond to what the Holy Spirit told you. Now, for most of us, that just means, oh, wow, I've been thinking this way, I should think that way, or now I understand the text better and I can believe it more accurately. For most Sundays, that's probably how it's going to be, because hopefully you're confessed up before you ever get here. One old pastor said, fess them as you do them. Don't wait till Sunday. You know, you won't remember them. Just as you sin, when the Lord, as soon as the Lord shows it to you, you can agree with him about it. Say, Lord, that was wrong. Please forgive me. But when you come here and the Lord speaks to you, of course, every Sunday there should be something that we look at and go, wow, I see something to give thanks for. I see something to repent of. I see something to change about how I relate to my spouse or how I parent my kids or whatever it may be. Sometimes it's public. You need, the Bible says, confess your sins one to another. So sometimes you need to go respond and talk to a pastor and say, hey, let's talk soon. There's some things I need to talk about that I'm dealing with. Sometimes it's, we need to make this our church home. Sometimes it's, I need to give my life to Jesus. Sometimes it's, I need to get baptized. When it's a public type thing, then that's how people respond. Now, if the Holy Spirit does what we ask him to do and believe that he does, as I'm preaching to the congregation as a whole, like a shotgun approach, he's got the rifle approach, and he's sitting down and he's talking to you one-on-one, and he's saying, you know, I love you. You know, I've got your best interest at heart. You know, I'm trying to bring you into the image of Jesus Christ and give you a life more abundant. Well, we're not going to get there as long as this is here. And he points out something in your life. If you ignore that and you go, yeah, well, I like it, and I'm not giving it up. If you ignore that and you say, I know Jesus doesn't want that in my heart, but I do, and I'm the boss. Or if you say, if maybe the Holy Spirit says, you know, what he said about solitude, you really are kind of a workaholic. And that's not why you were created. You weren't created to work primarily. You were created to worship primarily. And your work will be a lot more fulfilling if you'll get your worship right. And so you need to get that discipline in your life. You say, well, you know what? I got bills to pay. No rest for the wicked. When you ignore the voice of God, you do it to your own detriment. And for this reason, some of you are weaker than you ought to be. Some of you are sicker than you ought to be. And perhaps death is closer than it should be for some of you. It says in verse 32, "But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for judgment. And about the other things, I will give direction when I come." He said, when you come together, it should be for the better, but it wasn't true for Corinth, it was for the worse. How are we doing? How are we doing when we come together as a church family? Is it something that progressively you look at and see it as something you get to do, not something you have to do? I remember times in my life where church was a have to. Reading my Bible was, oh, I ought to do that. Now I'm at a place where it's more like now I get to worship. I wake up on Monday looking forward to the next Sunday. Not because I'm the preacher. I did that before I was preaching. I just love church. It's for the better. Is it for you? Is it for the better? It will be if you get it wrapped around Jesus Christ, if you respond to what he's telling you to do. I read a story today. It was two couples. They were, the first couple had a child, and the child died a tragic death. But the parents had enough foresight and wisdom and grace to make the decision that when the physician came and said, you know, your child is no longer with us, but his organs are still very valuable and can be used for good for someone who needs them, would you be willing to donate your child's organs to another young person? And the mom and dad agreed to do that. Because of that, another couple who had a little boy was able to save his life. And he flourished. Not too long after all of this, some organization or the physician or the hospital, I don't know who it was, but somebody brought the two couples together. The journalist who was writing the article was there to observe it. And she said, when the two parents, two dads and two moms, when they walked in and they saw each other, they embraced and they just wept for a long time. And they realized and they recognized that that little boy is alive and well because of the life-giving death of their son. And when I read that, I thought, you know, that's how communion really ought to be. It's every Sunday ought to be. You're living life, it's chaotic, it's crazy. Then you get here to church. Even getting to church sometimes is, I've got to rededicate my life two or three times just coming from Yulee. And I get here, and I make it by the grace of God. Service starts. In the early service today, it was victory in Jesus. As soon as John sang it, it reorients everything, all the crazy junk in life around the life-giving death of another. And then when I look out at you, and some of you I know better than others, some of you I know a lot of your story and some of the pain that you've gone through, and when I remember that, you know, there are some of you that you've gotten bad reports. There's some of you you're facing cancer, and that's terrifying. But then I remember that there's nothing wrong with you that a good resurrection won't correct. And I remember the life-giving death of another, and the victory we have in Jesus Christ. And I'm not going to do it because I'm probably too just prideful. But sometimes I just want to have a big, like, huddle where we just cry together for an hour on Sunday and just recognize you couldn't go to hell if you wanted to, because all of your sin was paid for by Jesus Christ. Wow. And he's got a purpose and a plan for you. You say, well, Pastor, I've goofed up. He's not going to use me anymore. That's not how he operates. You see, you know he's got a plan for you because you're still breathing. And he wants to use you for his glory. And if we can just tap into that, you will wake up on Monday morning and you would say, look, every day is the Lord's day in one sense, and I can glorify God on Monday morning just like I can on Sunday morning, but there's something about the Lord's day. And I can't wait to get back with my people and his people and come together around the life-giving death of Jesus Christ and us to feast on the benefits of his broken body and his shed blood. And they are legion. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. This is that time that we talked about where you kind of tune in and you just say, what is God saying to me personally? And what is my response to be? For some, in the early service, it was that they needed to unite with this family of faith in an official way. There's a sense in which we don't like official stuff in our world, but you know, when you become a citizen, you're to do that officially. You're to stand up and make a commitment before your fellow citizens. When you become married, you do that in an official capacity. And if you want to unite with a church family, it's proper and right that you let it be known that you're going to be a vital part of this family. And so if God is calling you, then both the Spirit and the bride say, come. We're calling you. If he's moving upon you to make this your home, I promise you it would overjoy our hearts if you would just respond to him. Maybe you're here and you say, Pastor, I've never looked forward to reading the Bible. I've never looked forward to praying or going to church. That could be a sign that you've never been saved. Why don't you take some time and just take inventory and ask yourself, has there been a time that you've recognized you were a sinner and that you from the heart called out on Jesus to save you because you recognize he died for your sins? He paid for it in full and he was raised again from the dead. Is he your Savior and Lord? If not, this would be the appropriate time for you to respond. If you're here, whatever else it is that God's leading you to do, there should be something for everybody. They won't all be public. But if it's a public decision he's calling you to, this will be the proper time as soon as I say amen to this prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, speak to your children, for we're listening. And God, I don't think we can do anything perfectly in a fallen sense, but if you speak to us, we will purpose to obey, knowing that delayed obedience is disobedience. So would you be good enough, as we said earlier, to speak that truth to us that even may hurt, but give us a chance to respond to you in obedience and faith. And Father, we'll give you the thanks for your goodness to us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's stand to our feet. If God's leading you, you come.